I'm very excited to talk about with you. And I think it's very interesting that you all have created, you know, a small business development center. I don't know if Herman has talked to you. You know, we have a very organized small business development center in the U.S. That's okay. Good.
We met with them actually also, yes.
Perfect. Okay. And I got to work with the Temple Small Business Development Center in my role at Temple. So I'm going to talk with you today about angel investors and venture capital and a few other types of investing. And before I start, I think something that's important to understand is that angel investing and venture capital, they tend to invest in companies that are not your typical small businesses. When I think of small businesses, I think of things like, you know, dry cleaners or hair salons or accounting services, things like that. We tend to focus on, you know, companies like, you know, that have the opportunity to really grow. So they tend to be technology companies or life science companies. It's harder for angel investors to invest in these smaller companies because the goal of angel investing is to get a return on your investment. That's not a loan. And the way we get the return is somebody buys that company or the company goes public. Okay. All right. So I want to talk a little bit first about what we call the early stage funding ecosystem. So in the beginning, we really encourage companies to self-fund, or you may have heard the term bootstrap, as much as possible. And so that might mean, you know, putting your own savings into the company. It might mean using credit cards to fund the company. You know, it might mean doing consulting on the side that allows you to put money into the company. Once you've gotten past that stage, typically what happens is we call it friends and family, or friends, family, and fools, people who are people who are willing to take a chance on you. And they do that because they know you, okay? So that's different than getting a professional investor to invest in your company. These are friends who are putting money in. It could be a loan. It could be you might give them shares in the company. That happens fairly early on. And those tend to be smaller amounts. Another way that companies here get money early on, if they are a product company, they can get they can do what's called crowdfunding. So you may have heard of Kickstarter or Indiegogo. And those are platforms where you present what you're creating and people, they're not investing. They are kind of like early purchasers, if that makes sense. So, you know, for example, there's a company that has a new kind of breast pump for breastfeeding. And they put it on a crowdfund. They did a crowdfunding campaign and people paid for the product in advance of its being developed, which helped fund the company enough that they could actually manufacture the product. They didn't have enough money to manufacture the product and then hope that people would buy it. So crowdfunding is an important tool that we use here for product companies. Okay. The next way that people here get funding, there are business plan competitions, you know, where you're pitching your company and you win a prize. Someone puts up a prize, an organization puts up a prize, and you pitch, and the best pitch gets some money. There are incubators, which the Small Business Development Center, I'm sure, talked about. And then there's what we call accelerators. And accelerators are programs. They may be 12 weeks long. For example, you get assigned a mentor, and you go from idea to an actual company over that time period. And then you get introduced to investors. And the accelerators will often put in some money into the company to give them enough money to develop the, you know, the company while it's in the accelerator. There's also regional agencies. That's a big thing here. Regional agencies that are putting money into companies. That might be at the state level. It might be at the city level. It might be at the country level. And so that's a very important source of funding for our companies. And then you had the angel investors who are investing pretty early in the companies, but not as early as friends and family might. And then next we have venture capitalists. I'm going to talk to you about angel. I'm going to first talk about the difference between angels and venture capitalists, and then I'm going to go into detail about each one. Okay? Ivana, are there any questions I need to answer before I move forward?
No, I don't think so.
Okay.
If we have any, we'll keep them for later.
Okay, great. Okay. So the difference between angels and venture capitalists, who we call VCs. So angels tend, they're investing their own money. And they tend to be entrepreneurs who've been successful. They're usually not people who come from wealth. It's usually entrepreneurs who've made their own money. And they invest their own money, typically close to home. And by that, I mean geographically close to home, but also industry. They tend to invest in industries that they understand. So if their business was, let's say it was an insurance technology platform, they might invest in other insurance companies or other technology companies. They may not be as comfortable investing, for example, in a consumer product.
I'm sorry, Ellen. This is Ella, the translator. Would you please repeat the last part? I'm sorry to interrupt you, but
sure.
It seems that the internet connection maybe on my part or your part is not stable. So I lost the last part. Would you please repeat it? Sorry.
Oh, so they're so they invest their money in things they understand, both geographically close to home and industries they've been involved with before. So, you know, if they made their money in a insurance technology company, then they might be interested in investing in insurance companies or technology companies. They're not as comfortable investing in things they don't understand, like life sciences, for example. But they might join a group, and we'll talk about groups in a few minutes. They might join a group so they get to invest in things that are a little bit outside their area of expertise. So angels are entrepreneurs who've made their money and have maybe sold their businesses. And they are introducing capital, and we call it patient capital because they know it could take 7 to 10 years before they get any money back. Some are less patient than others, which is why I have a question mark. But they tend to be more patient because they are entrepreneurs themselves and they relate to the entrepreneurs. We have companies we've invested in. We've been in for 10, 12, even more years. That's not great, but we understand that that might happen. They also contribute contacts. We will connect entrepreneurs to people that we know to help them grow. And we get involved in helping them think through their early strategy. Angel's focus is they want to make money, but they also want to give back by helping grow companies, okay? They're not in it just for the money. And that's something that it's really important to understand about angels. And some angels will do it by themselves, but many angels organize in groups or clubs in order to invest. And we'll talk about that in a minute. So that's angels. Now let's look at the difference between angels and venture capitalists. Venture capitalists are professional investors. They tend to have well-defined strategies for the funds that they manage. And they're managing other people's money. It's not theirs, okay? So that's a very big difference between angels are writing their own checks. Venture capitalists are investing other people's money. They come from strong professional backgrounds. They may be entrepreneurs or have served as executives in companies. They may be bankers or consultants. And some people start in venture capital and stay in it their whole careers. But so that it's a, you know, they're coming at it from, this is a business that I'm running. They also contribute capital's contacts and strategy, but their focus is to make money because they're investing other people's money. They are responsible for managing that money to make money. Now, they don't want to take over or run your company, but they will do what it takes to protect the investment. And if that means making a big change in the company, they will do that. Angels don't tend to do that as much. Okay, so that's some of the big differences. Both angels and venture capitalists, they have to see an exit in order to get money. And that's something that early stage companies need to understand, that when we invest, we expect an exit. It's not a loan. You know, we don't want to be paid back by dividends or by interest for the most part. We want to see an exit. And an exit might be another company acquiring your company, or it might be an IPO, which are very rare, but they happen. So usually it's an acquisition. So we want to understand, what kind of acquisition do you think would happen? So let's talk first about angel investors. So angel investors, as I said before, they tend to be entrepreneurs who have exited their company or are making enough money from the company and have time to focus on investing. Most of the members of my angel group, Robinhood Ventures, are no longer working full-time running a company. They live in the area and they want to invest and help grow companies. So what are angels looking for? They're looking to make 10 to 20 times their money in 5 years. That's the dream, okay? It doesn't happen. You know, only a few companies in our portfolio actually do that. But we have to believe that any company that we invest in will make 10 to 20 times our money in 5 years. We're looking at a committed management team that really wants the help of the angels and wants their investment. And we're also looking for a management team that has put their own money in and that are full-time and fully committed to growing the company and fully committed to an exit. Some entrepreneurs want to grow a company. We call it a lifestyle company that they'll be with for the rest of their lives, you know, and maybe, you know, hand down to their family. That is not the kind of company that angels are looking for. We're also looking for involvement in the venture. When we invest, we hope to get a board seat in the company and help influence the direction. So what's the process for getting funded by an angel? So if it's an angel group, then companies will apply for funding. And then we have a screening committee that will look at the applications. Ours goes every month. So we might have 30 companies that apply for funding, and we'll select 3 to 4 companies a month that we think are ready to come into the group and present. So they will present to our group. And if there's enough interest in the group to consider an investment, we'll put together a due diligence committee that will really get into a lot of detail with the company. We'll look at, and I'll talk about what we're looking at in a minute. But we really get pretty deep into the company when we're doing due diligence. once we're satisfied that we really think the company is a strong company and investable, then we start negotiating, and then we do the deal. And then at that point, the company starts progressing. So things to understand before getting involved with angels: the company has to make sure that they're ready to have a partner who's going to want to have some influence. They have to be ready to have a board of directors, which gets created once there's an investment. And the board makes some of the decisions. The company makes, you know, all the day-to-day decisions, but there's some strategy decisions and some funding decisions that the board of directors participates in. They have to be prepared to deliver monthly or quarterly financials and strategic updates. And an important thing, you know, for a company to do is to engage an attorney to a lawyer who can help set up the right structured deal. That's really important to get the right attorney. So one of the things you're going to want to do if you all decide that you want to create some kind of angel group or venture group is you're going to want to also create a network of advisors, mentors, attorneys, accountants who can help these companies be ready for the investment. That's a really important, infrastructure that we've built here in Philadelphia and other cities have. So we have a very strong infrastructure of people who can help the companies with that. So what do we want to know about the company? We want to know what's the opportunity. How big is the opportunity? If the company has a very small market, that's not that interesting to us because it's not going to grow enough for someone to want to acquire the company and for us to eventually get our money back. We really want to know the ins and outs of how the company actually makes money. And we want to know, you know, who's the customer? Do you have customers that are ready to buy? And from the customer's perspective, and we'll talk to customers sometimes, we want to know, is this, you know, really important and essential? Or is this just a nice to have? And we tend to want to invest in things that are just really essential to the customers. Okay. So, you know, an example might be if they have a software platform, is that something that companies just think would be nice to have? Or is it really urgent for them to run their businesses better? Okay. Can you defend your product in the market? And then we have a phrase called, what's the secret sauce? You know, what makes you really unique? And, what do you have that nobody else has? Okay. We want to know, can you execute? Can you make things happen? Do you have a track record? Do you have a history of making things happen, of making progress? And then the last thing we want to know is what will you do with our money? How will you use our money? Okay. All right. So we talk about this a lot. The three main things we look at is the management team. How good is the management team? And we know the management team isn't full at the time we're investing. That's part of what our money is doing. But the people that are in the team so far, you know, do they understand the market? Are they, again, do they have a good track record of success? Do we think that they are good listeners? That's really important to us. Do they listen? Do they take in information and then know what to do with it? And are they able to deal with, taking in that information, learning that, you know, they might not be right on track with their idea and that they need to make some changes. And how quickly can they make those changes? So many of the companies in our portfolio thought they were going, you know, they came to us and they said, we're going to sell to, you know, we're going to sell directly to consumers and we're going to do that by our website. And they learned that selling by the website might not be the right strategy for their company. And they get that information and they say, okay, we've got to change how we're selling. We're going to try and sell in stores. And here's the strategy to sell directly in, you know, in stores. So they have to, you know, they have to be able to take in information and make changes. So that's what we're looking at. We're looking at the market. Again, how big is it? And how well defined is that market? And how interested is the market in the opportunity that they're coming up with? So that's really critical. So for example, we just invested in a company that has created technology for helping people not lose their hair when they go through chemo. And we needed to understand how big was that market. And at first we thought it was pretty small, the number of people who could afford to pay for this and the number of healthcare providers that would find this interesting. But the more work we did with the company, we realized the market is big enough to support quick growth. And so we invested. And then we look at the product. How is the product built out? You know, is it the right product for the market? Do they have what we call product market fit? Do they have some proof that they've identified a market and a product that market wants? And that's what we call product market fit. And that's when we tend to invest, both, that's when angels come in, when they've hit what we call product market fit. Some proof that there's a product for a particular market. So these are things that individual angels think about. With angel groups, you know, there's more of a process that we have to go through to make sure we understand this and that people in the group are comfortable with that product. There's also another way so you've got the individual angels, you've got the groups. And then one thing that we have here that's been really critical are different forums that bring investors together, not just necessarily in their own group, but bring all types of investors together to hear the companies. And then if they think it's interesting, then they will then talk to the companies. So it helps companies who may not be able to attract investors just by sending in an application get in front of investors. So an example of that is a forum that I run called Mid-Atlantic Diamond Ventures, and it's hosted by my University Temple. And as part of that process, we actually provide coaching and mentoring to the entrepreneurs to present to the investors. So this is something you may want to be thinking about as a first step to getting investors interested and getting companies that you're working with in front of investors. This is something that a lot of regions do. They host these events to get people excited about it. We do these quarterly. We think that's, so a lot of forums are annually. And if the company needs money in January and the forum's not till September, that doesn't really help the company. So by doing these quarterly, there's always a time when a company that needs the money might be able to participate. Okay. Our forum is fairly small. We usually bring 8 to 12 companies. Some of these venture forums are really big. You might have, you know, 20, 30, 40 companies. But this is a really nice start in regions to provide help to the entrepreneurs, but also to help investors get to know each other and give them access to the early stage companies. Okay, so that's angels. Let's talk about venture capital. So venture capital, if you think about financial asset classes, a venture is actually a pretty small asset class compared to some of the others, but it's really important to the economy. The share of venture, the share of IPOs that are VC backed, that have VC funding in them, is really huge if you look at this, right? And so even though they're a very small class, they have a very big impact both here and throughout. So let's talk a little bit about the VC fund structure. Generally, there's a fund, okay? They put together a fund. It might be $10 million, $20 million, $100 million, $1 billion. They put together a fund. The fund is run by what's called a general partner, and there's a management company that's part of the general partner. They're responsible for running the fund, okay? And for that, they get management fees and carried interest and all, whoops, sorry, must be on a timer. I'll talk a little bit about more about how that works. And then you have the investors, and we call them LPs or limited partners. They're investing in the fund. That's where the money comes from. So I said before that venture capitalists are investing other people's money. That's those investors, the limited partners. The people who are running the fund are the GPs or general partners. The fund then invests in many different companies, okay? So that's the general structure for a venture capital fund. So where does that venture capital money come from? It comes from government funds. So the state of California might put in money, from their fund. Pension funds are a big source of venture funding because they're trying to vary the investments and the timelines that they do. So on the, they have some very stable investments for the pension funds. And then they have the venture funding as the, brings higher returns, but higher risks. Banks might put some money in venture funding. Institutional investors, which is a bigger asset class, might put some money into venture funds. And then there are accredited investors who put money in venture funds. People who have a lot of wealth might put money in a venture fund. Okay. So how do venture funds work? They invest in these companies. And so how do they make money, right? So they make money every year. They pull from the fund. So let's say they raised $100 million. Dollars for the fund, they pull 2 to 2.5% of the amount committed to the fund. So if it's $100 million fund, they're pulling off $2 million a year from the fund to actually run the group and pay for the people in the fund. Okay. And then there's carried interest, and that's where they really make their money. So what happens is when as there are exits, as companies get acquired, the venture capitalists start returning money to the investors in the fund. And the way they do it is they give 80% to the people who invested, and they keep 20% for themselves because they're doing all the work. They're finding the company. They have the, you know, they have the real skills to do this. So they get 20% of the investment. So, so for example, in $100 million, there's $100 million fund, and the companies they've invested in return $300 million back. So they pay back the first $100 million of the fund. From the $300 million, right? So that everyone gets their money back. And then the 20% of what remains after paying back the $100 million fund, they get 20% or $40 million, and the LPs get Oh my God, 160 million, okay. So sorry, had to do math in my head for a minute, whoops. So the investors are very happy because they made a lot of money on their investment, and the general partners are very happy because they got 40 million, for the work that they did. And the interest is allocated amongst the people in the management company. There's partners, and there may be other people who are getting interest, who are getting allocated from that 40 million. If you're like a junior analyst, you just get a salary. You may or may not get any of that 40 million. So that's how their structure works. Okay, so the time horizon of a venture fund is important to understand. So let's say a fund is 10, there's 10 years in the fund. So the first, and they get the 100 million committed. People say we're definitely going to put 100 million, but they don't draw down all that money. They don't take all that money. They do what's called capital calls. So, and they don't make all their investments on day one. They make it over time. So in the first, I'm looking at the orange. In the first part, the first few years, they're making initial investments, and then they're doing some follow. So they're doing, let's say they do 10 investments. They're not investing all 100 million in those first few years, but they're making the initial investments. Over time, they have to do follow-on investments because the companies reach, they make progress and they need more money. So they do some follow-on investments, years 3 through 6. And then they're really moving to get exits from the company and be able to close down the fund. So they really start pushing the companies towards an exit. And then the last couple of years, they get very aggressive in exits because they really only have a life, they only have a 10-year life in the fund, and they don't want to have to continue the fund beyond that. So that's what's happening with investments. At the same time, what's happening with the investors, the people who put their money in, is generally there's what's called a capital call. They're drawing down on the commitments that people made, about 20% in each of the first 5 years. So if it's a $100 million fund, they're getting $20 million a year over the first 5 years. Okay, and again, that money is going into the initial investments and then the follow-on investments. And then usually, as I said, they're moving to monetize. They're moving to get the companies to get bought over, years like 5 to 8. And as the companies are acquired, that's when the capital starts being distributed back to the investors, to the LPs upon the exits. At the same time, the venture capitalists are already starting to create their next fund, because again, this has a 10-year life cycle. So they want to create another fund. So they really have to be able to show a good performance. They have to show that they've made good choices and that there's going to be a good return. So that's why they get, they get kind of aggressive so that they can raise more money. Okay. So how does venture capital math work? So they figure that of the $100 million that they invest, and again, I use $100 million as an example because it's easy to do the math. 33% or one third of the companies are a total loss. The companies fail outright, and the venture fund gets none of their money back. About 22%, they get their capital back. So the company might have had an exit, but it's not a good exit. All they got is their money back. But at least they're not losing money. And then you have, you know, again, about 23%. This is on average across, this was done on a research study. Every firm has different returns, but on average, this is what happens. So about 23% is what we call a solid venture return. You get 3 to 5 times your money. So, you know, if you invested $10 million in a company, it gets acquired, then the venture capitalist, the fund gets back, you know, $30 million to $50 million. That's great. You know, they start celebrating at that. But it's the big winners that they really need in order to have a successful portfolio. And that's 10 times, you know, that's like a 10 times their money. So if you look at how that works, you know, they're a good firm will return, about $3.34 for every dollar that gets invested. Okay. So that's the end of my presentation. I'm excited to take your questions. I'm going to look at the chat room. And it's all about translation. Okay. So I'm open for questions. What questions do you have? And you can ask them out loud if you'd like.
I think I saw somebody raised hand earlier, but no.
Whoops.
Hi, Ellen. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Magda is speaking. She thanks you very much for your insightful presentation.
Thank you.
And these two styles or two models of funding for entrepreneurs might not be suitable for the local communities we work in. Let me give you or set you an example. When it comes to VCs or pension funds, not everyone here in the communities can participate in such a thing.
Mm-hmm. That's true everywhere, I think. It's a very small number of people that do this. The other thing that might be possible in some countries that don't have a lot of investors, they are able to raise money from, you know, other parts of the country or other parts of the world who want to invest in your regions. Sometimes local government groups might create a venture fund, but they'll ask business people to run those funds. So that happens. So for example, in Philadelphia, we have a fund that has state money in it, and it's administered by a combination of government and local people, they have business people, successful entrepreneurs and investors who are helping make those decisions and funding. Does that help?
I'd like to thank you for the first part. Let me ask you another question. This has to do with angel investing.
Mm-hmm.
I think trust should be pretty high between the two partners because no partner can cast doubts on the other one or can be worried to put their own money in this company, or maybe I feel that I'm contributing but I might be losing my money. Because, you know, sometimes people have hidden agendas or have hidden interests, and that might undermine trust. So what are the guarantees, if I may say, even if you have an attorney or a lawyer drafting a contract, how can you make sure that trust is maintained and the rights of each party are maintained in order to make sure that small investors will not incur the loss, and maybe a bigger investors will survive while other investors will be crushed.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Wonderful question. Thank you. So, trust can't be created by legal documents. There are definite legal documents that have been created, and they're actually standard, and they're used for all types of venture deals. But so first of all, investors have to understand that they are going to lose their money most of the time. And that's why you only need one company that you invest in to be a big win to take care of all the companies that fail. So you have to be comfortable, and very few people are, you have to be comfortable that you are going to lose money. But the way that the trust occurs is generally by being actively involved in the company, by getting a board seat. That's where the trust comes from. And also by the company has to report back to the investors on a regular basis. Here's the progress we've made. Here's the problems we're having. Here's where our money's going. That is where the trust comes from the for the investors to be able to trust the company. Now, for the early stage investors trusting the larger investors, there are some legal terms that protect the early stage companies. And those are pretty standard terms as well. But let's say the company really needs a lot of money and the big investor is willing to put that money in. Sometimes the smaller investors who put their money really in may have to take terms that they're not as comfortable with, because you really need that venture capitalist money. And the early stage investors understand that going in. But generally, there are certain rights and protections that protect the angel investor over time. So those are very important to put in. That's a whole nother topic for another day. There's some really good information on that that's available. And there's some very good books on angel investing and venture capital. If you're interested in that, I can certainly send that to Ivana so you have that. But the trust issue really comes by that involvement with the company. And that's why due diligence takes a while. I talked about due diligence up front with the company. That could take a while. That could take 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, even more. And during that time, the investor and the company are learning to trust each other. And it's just as hard for the company to develop trust in the investors, right? They have to feel really comfortable that that investor has their best intentions. And one of the things that helps with that is the investors develop a good reputation over time. So that's something an investor has to do. They have to create a good reputation. In my angel group, Robinhood, we actually have, we call it a no jerks policy, which is we don't let anyone in the group that we think doesn't have high integrity or might not have the company's interests at heart, or might even talk rudely to an entrepreneur. We can't have that. If we get a reputation for being mean to the companies aren't going to want to take our money. So those are some of the ways that trust comes in.
Shukran.
If I
thank
can,
you very much.
Can I jump in, Ala, if you don't mind, just to translate for the friends who don't understand,
sure.
To give a little bit also sure. of background why we decided to include the topic of angel investing and venture capital into this presentation. Because we kind of need to keep our horizons broadened. And as you know, things are changing, and the support for traditional international development might be shrinking in the future. There is more and more pressure on kind of using private sector or creating partnerships with private sector to support development. It's maybe good to just look at the ideas of what is happening right now, just for the future, mm-hmm. and think about how this could be even adapted for the local conditions, mm-hmm. especially the idea of angel investing, which might be, you know, in some scale, more appropriate or adaptable. So this is kind of a background of that idea. So we do understand that right now, you know, talking about working in very poor communities and often with illiterate people, you know, it's kind of hard to connect these two.
Right.
In maybe some form or, you know, some adaptation of the idea, it still might be a good idea. Mm-hmm. And with that, I was going to ask Ellen, actually, if you can paint us an example of like one company that your angel investing company kind of supported, and, you know, maybe their profile or, you know, how that worked. Maybe I don't want to take too much of your time, but just to maybe give us a little bit more practical example.
Sure. Okay. Why am I... I'm sorry, I'm just... one company that we invested in had taken some research that was done on Alzheimer's, which is a real problem, you know, very big problem, very big market, very big problem. And they took this research and they came up with a different way of solving the Alzheimer's problem. And we invested very early in the company. We continued to invest in the company. We connected them to different experts. And they just went public a few months ago. So we're very excited about that. And you know, that means once a company goes public, they can bring even more money in than we brought. So that's an example of a company that we put money in that had an exit. We invested in a company, another life science company is looking at, and I'm not a scientist, but they're looking at immunocells that will, a different process of trying to cure cancer. And so that company just went public. It's very rare that it happens, and we just happen to have two companies in 1 year that went public. It's very, very rare. Most of our companies get bought by another company. Mm-hmm. In the communities that you're talking about, I know this is like very, you know, kind of big and sounds like a lot of money and all that sort of thing, but you can take the concepts and scale them down much smaller. So you could, you know, you could talk about, and we actually did this for something, you could create a much smaller fund, you know, a $25,000 fund, which might, you know, if you, you know, because there are companies that if they had $1,000 that would make a big difference for them. So, you know, an example here, Herman probably knows this group, it's the Merchants Fund. And so they've got a much smaller budget than what I've been talking about. But, you know, if a store needs a new sign or needs better refrigeration or needs to, you know, help with marketing, they put some money into those stores to help them, you know, succeed and grow. It's a much smaller fund, but if you think about it, it's still a fund. Mm-hmm. Companies still have to apply and they go through a process to determine, you know, how much money to put in. There's a crowdfunding organization called Kiva, K-I-V-A. Are you familiar with Kiva? Okay. Yeah. So that's, you know, that's the same concept on a much, you know, again, a much smaller level. You know, angel investing, again, is, you know, it tends to be more money, but you can scale these concepts down, I think.
I agree. That's a good point. It looks like we might have some questions. So,
okay. I think it was Kiva, it looked like, on the chat.
Oh, did I say Kiva?
Kiva. I didn't see any other questions yet.
Wael, I think, raised his hand. Wael, okay. I have a question. And then we also have Nabil as a... so we'll take one and then another one. So there is often a pause because we are actually waiting for this to be translated in Arabic. So. Mm-hmm.
أنا ممكن أسأل سؤال.
Hi there. As for your presentation, I'd like to thank you very much. It's a new concept. I think it's there in Egypt, but our background in this is very limited, to be honest. Any investor or any VC wants to make money. They are for profit, of course. They are not for any loss. So my question is, at which stage can we engage the VEC? Is it from day one? Are they involved in the feasibility study? Do they study the life cycle? Are they a partner since day one? Or can we engage them later? If they are on the right track, if they start to make money and move forward, then they would love to be engaged.
Yes. So venture.
So when and where?
Yes. So, you know, I talked about with angel investors, they tend to get involved, you know, when you can prove in some way that there's a market that wants your product. Venture capitalists tend to get involved when there's significant revenue, $1 million, for example, $2 million. They usually will make it very clear on their websites how much money, how much revenue you need to have. But they do want to start talking to the companies earlier so they get to know them. So again, that trust that was asked about earlier, that trust gets built up. So they'll talk to companies earlier. They probably won't talk to them when they're, you know, just in the idea stage, but once the product, either the software or the, you know, the drug, you know, or the, you know, whatever it is, is at a prototype stage, they'll start talking, but they won't. Venture capitalists don't invest until there's actual revenue. Now, it occurs to me there's another model. So yes, venture capitalists want to make money and they want a big return, but a model we have here, again, it's called an evergreen fund. And what happens is an organization raises some money upfront, let's say $1 million or $10 million. And they invest in companies. As the company, and this is generally a not-for-profit, okay? So their goal is not to make money. Their goal is to fund as many companies as they can. So they've got their $10 million fund. They will invest, you know, they'll invest in 10 or 20 companies. And then as those companies have an exit or start to make money, the companies will either, you know, pay them back a dividend or they'll have an exit. And the money from the exit goes back into the evergreen fund and then they spend that money on more companies. So we have an a company, for example, it came from the tobacco companies. They had to make reparations for the bad things that they did with tobacco. They had to give states money. And what Pennsylvania did with the money, the tobacco money, is they created one of these evergreen funds. And that fund has been around for 25 years now. And they have funded, and you know, they have funded a lot of companies with that money. They just keep recycling the money over and over again. And they've become very good at picking companies to invest in. And they will invest earlier than a normal venture capital fund does, because they're willing to take a little more risk because it is a nonprofit. So that might be something to think about. I think there was another question.
Yes, I think we'll just give
a minute. Can I add something?
So Mr. Nabil would like to add something.
Okay.
I just want to know, or to build on what Ivana said. If you have some case studies that are documented, I mean practical examples that use the VCs or angel investing, I'd be very interested in. Also, I'd like to know more about the challenges entrepreneurs faced in this regard, or the risks that investors faced.
Mm-hmm. So, okay.
And also, the case studies shouldn't focus only on successes. Also, if some companies failed, mm-hmm. then we can study the lessons learned. This is very useful. We can build on, because this model is new in Egypt. And we want to know more about the models you have abroad. Thank you.
So, okay, great. I would suggest reaching out to the Kauffman Institute. The Kauffman Institute. They have assembled a lot of research and data and information and cases. So I would suggest reaching out to them. I can tell you, I actually have a lot more stories about what went wrong than what went right. So if you want, I'd be happy to talk about some companies where it went wrong. That's actually much easier. Just trying to think about recently. So, we invested in a software company where we knew the entrepreneur really well. We trusted that entrepreneur. They had a really good idea, but frankly, we were investing because of the entrepreneur, and we didn't do enough due diligence on the entrepreneur because we knew them. We were just kind of doing it because we knew and trust that person had been successful in the past. And his idea, the technology was a little bit too far out from where the market was. People weren't ready for his idea, and he couldn't get anyone to buy his product. And so that is, shame on us for not doing the due diligence that we would normally do. So that's an example. A lot of the companies that fail because they think they have, a product that the market wants, but what they learn is that the time to make the sale takes way too long, or the decision-making process takes too long. This happens a lot in healthcare, for example. So someone might come up with a really cool software application for hospitals, and the first hospital says, whoa, this is great. We can really use it. It fits in our process, right? And so the company gets really excited because they have one customer who says, this is great. And then they go out and get funding based on that one customer. But then when they go out and try and get other customers, they can't get anyone to sign on because they didn't do enough homework to see, is it just that one customer or is it others? I was an entrepreneur at one point, and I made that mistake and I knew better. We created a platform, and ING, you know, big worldwide company, bought our platform and our services. And we thought, man, we've conquered the world. You know, ING likes this. They're ready to pay for it. Everybody else should just jump in line after ING. We couldn't sell it to anybody else. We had to fold. I mean, you know, we made some nice consulting money from ING, but we did not make, enough money to grow the company. There just wasn't a big enough market out there. That's the number one reason why companies fail. Another reason why companies fail is that the founders have different goals and views for where the company wants to go. And that's one of the things one of the founders wants to grow. And one of the founders, you know, let's go international. And one of the founders says, let's get really good, you know, in one geographic market and prove the model out and then go broader. And they're both good approaches, but if they're not in agreement, they're not going to come up with a strategy that works. And there's always going to be that tension between let's go broad and let's go deep. And then all the other decisions, they can't perform because there's limited resources in entrepreneurial companies. So you have to have a clear strategy and put all your energy behind that strategy until the market tells you, you need to change your strategy. But so if you have entrepreneurs who aren't agreeing, that's the second reason, you know, that we see companies failing. It's either the market or something happens with the founders. Companies don't fail because the product's not right. You can always fix the product, but you can't fix the market and you can't fix the founders. So hopefully that's a good specific. I don't like to use the names of the failures, but hopefully that gives you an idea of some things that happen. And then we've got a company right now. It's a great company. They're making money. They're making like $5 or $6 million a year in revenue. That's great, but they're not growing at a rate that someone wants to acquire them. So we are now 11 years into that investment and we don't see an exit coming. So we're happy that the company is doing well, but it's not doing well enough to give us an exit. So we're not going to see any money from it for a long time. So that's something else that happens. And then what you get is you get the investor starting to push the entrepreneur to sell, and the entrepreneur might not ready to, they might not be ready to sell. And so, you know, that causes some problems, some issues.
Thank you. Yes, sure.
Thank you so much. You answered my question.
Good. Thank you. Okay.
Any other questions?
Doesn't look like it.
It doesn't seem, yeah. So, right, in that case, if there are no more questions, we can bring this meeting to a close and say thank you to our speaker today.
Well, thank you very much for allowing me to speak with you. And I wish you all tremendous success in helping grow companies in your local communities. It's a wonderful mission that you have. And I thank you for doing that. Thank you.
Shukran gazilan likum.
Translation. Hey. Allah, are you saying something still? Sorry.
No, I'm done.
Okay.
I'm pretty fast.
great. Okay, and we will be sharing a translated copy of the presentation as well as the video link. We are recording this meeting, so we'll share it with everybody. Ellen, I will send a copy to you as well for your records. And maybe this will be a seed that's planted now and some ideas or, you know, some new imagination will come out, who knows, months later or so on. So this is great to know that this type of resources exist. Thank you, Ellen, again. We know you are very busy, so thank you for your generous time.
Thank you. Okay,
and
thank you.
Bye, everybody. Bye for today. Bye, Ellen. Thank you.
Bye-bye.